Great seers of ancient India have talked about the supreme swan or the Paramahamsa. Born with the ability to fly minutes after it pushes itself through its shell, this supreme swan soars into the sky without touching the ground. People of great spiritual realization have always been called supreme swans or Paramahamsas, for they attain the state of inner bliss and enlightenment before getting caught in the web of world's reality. They are enlightened souls who have received the truth of the universe and communicate it to the rest of humanity. They live in God or the eternal and inspire us to move in the right direction to become like them and attain the same state of bliss achieved by them. Through them, millions of people have experienced spiritual upliftment and attained salvation. From time immemorial, India has been the land of spirituality and holiness, unmatched by any other country in the world. India has given birth to great Paramahamsas, mystics, saints, and divine avatars who have consistently delivered this world from darkness to light. One such enlightened master, exuding divine grace, overwhelming compassion, and unfathomable spiritual knowledge, all at a very young age, is Paramahamsa Nityananda.
Nityanandam namostude koti surya swarupinam anandaganda ishwaram bhakta hridaya nivasinam nityanandam namostude
One of India's most enduring personalities, he has won the hearts of millions with his simple philosophy of eternal bliss and meditation as the true path to self-realization. Working towards a society of bliss, his simple teachings and meditation techniques work towards creating an atmosphere of equal vision, balanced mind, righteousness, cosmic love, divine knowledge, spiritual upliftment, better emotional health and creativity in every walk of life to realize one's own self. Nityananda was born as Rajashekaran, the second son of his parents Arunachalam and Lokanayaki in the temple town of Tiruvannamalai, South India. Tiruvannamalai literally means Tiru Annamalai or revered inaccessible mountain. In Sanskrit, this mountain is termed as Arunachala or the unmoving morning star. This town in a remote corner of Tamil Nadu boasts of an unbroken lineage of enlightened masters for over 2000 years. Or should we say, continues to be the final destination for those in the quest of truth. Arunagirinathar, Virupakshadevar, Ramana Maharishi all hail from Tiruvannamalai and are revered even today for their supreme efforts in reinforcing the power of faith in the Supreme Being and self-realization. 10 days after he was born, the family astrologer predicted that Rajasekharan would grow up to become a Raja Sannyasi and guide the world, something his parents were not happy to hear. At the age of 10, Rajasekharan was initiated by Raghupati Yogi. In his moment of initiation, Rajasekharan was blessed with a vision of Parashakti. He went home and carved the vision he had in soapstone. Mataji Kuppamal A deeply pious friend of his grandmother nurtured his growing consciousness with apparent insight into Rajasekharan's greatness. One day, Rajasekharan was found etching a complex shape on a copper foil. It was the sacred Sri Chakra. The Sri Chakra is believed to be a diagrammatic representation of the cosmos. Sri Ramana Maharishi, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa and Sharada Devi were sources of inspiration for young Rajasekharan. At the age of 12, on the sacred day of Buddha Purnima, Rajasekharan had an intense encounter with the divine, an out-of-body experience that was to change the course of his life. By his 17th year, Rajasekharan's spiritual quest became too fierce to be ignored. He left home on a journey of arduous self-discovery with no assurance whatsoever, but only a glimpse of the divine he received at the age of 12. He wandered far and wide, studying and practicing meditation. From Tapovan in the Himalayas to Kanyakumari in the south, from Dwarka in the west to Ganga Sagar in the east, he wandered for 7 years in India and in Nepal. With just 2 pieces of clothing and a kamandalu, a holy water jug, and with no idea of where his next meal would be. One day in Gaurikund, he beheld a breathtaking vision. A young man with a glowing countenance and flowing locks was walking towards him with long strides and divine grace. Wonderstruck and gazing at him, Rajasekharan realized that this was none other than Mahavatar Babaji, the enlightened master dwelling in the Himalayas for thousands of years in perpetual youth. It was this great saint who looked at him and uttered the name Paramahamsa Sri Nityananda. An enlightened being in a physical body, young at heart but wise in mind, Rajasekharan undertook years of rigorous penance, intense meditation practices, and in-depth study of yoga, tantra, Vedanta, and Shaiva philosophies before he attained the ultimate state of consciousness, the state of Nityananda, or eternal bliss. Word of the charismatic saint rode the winds in every direction. People visited Nityananda from far and near. Effortlessly, he won their hearts. The time had come and Nityananda was ready to execute the real purpose of his divine birth, the purpose as a guru. as a master to the entire humanity. Guided by divine vision, Nityananda soon reached Bidadi on the outskirts of Bangalore, where he found the place of his ashram. 20 acres and a 600-year-old sacred banyan tree, as revealed in his vision, he spotted without a doubt. On that divine soil, on January 1st, 2003, was inaugurated Nityananda Dhyanapitam, his movement for meditation and inner transformation. Nityananda Dhyanapitam stands on the divine soil on which this mission of compassion has come alive. The ambience is a perfect blend of tradition and modernity. The lifestyle of the ashramites speaks of a revival of the ancient Vedic system. Life Bliss Foundation is his worldwide movement to spread his message of meditation and inner bliss. With its spiritual nerve center in Bangalore, India, and its Western Hemisphere headquarters in Los Angeles, USA, it operates through 1,000 centers and over 78 upcoming ashrams in 30 countries, causing transformation of humanity through transformation of the individual. Paramahamsa Nityananda, today, just 30 years of age, is an inspiring personality and enlightened master of our times. Ravaged by greed, violence, terror and fear, we fall prey to the stress and strains of the outer world, while the inner self cries to be understood. We are not just citizens or passport holders. Deep within, transcending our social personality, is the core of our being, is the divine energy which is our true nature. Time and again, masters have emerged to show the way and demystify the very purpose of existence. Paramahamsa Nityananda is one such realized master.
Person who creates formula to reproduce the understandings of the outer world. For example, Newton understood something in his life. He created a formula to reproduce the same understanding to every being, to every human being. Person who creates formula to reproduce the understandings and truths of the outer world is a scientist. Same way, person who creates formula to reproduce the experiences and the truth of the inner world is a Paramahamsa. Scientist creates formulas, Paramahamsas creates, they create meditation techniques. They create meditation techniques to reproduce the same understanding, same experience, same enlightenment which happened in them, same bliss which happened in them.
How does one describe this great master? The charm of a child, the healing hands of a doctor, the compassion of a mother, the wisdom of a guru. To those who struggle under the many burdens of life, his presence itself is the answer they seek. In his arms, thousands find refuge, the ailing, the needy, and the seekers of God. The Master is an invitation to a journey inwards. In his own words, just allow me to light your being, then you will know that you are pure consciousness and your being pure bliss.
People continuously ask me, so are you God? I again and again tell them, I am not here to prove I am God. I am here to prove you are God.
Nityam sharanam gacchami, dhyanam sharanam gacchami, anandam sharanam gacchami, nityanandam sharanam gacchami, nityam sharanam gacchami, dhyanam sharanam gacchami, anandam sharanam gacchami, nityanandam sharanam gacchami,
nityam charanam gacchami, dhyanam charanam gacchami, anandam charanam gacchami, nityanandam charanam gacchami,
nityam charanam gacchami, dhyanam charanam gacchami, anandam charanam gacchami, nityanandam charanam gacchami, nityam charanam gacchami, dhyanam charanam gacchami, anandam charanam gacchami, nityanandam charanam gacchami, nityam charanam gacchami, dhyanam charanam gacchami, anandam charanam gacchami, nityanandam charanam gacchami,
nityam charanam gacchami.
There is a beautiful story in Mahabharata. It's called Yakshaprasna. There was a demigod who had a quiz program with Yudhishthira, was asking all questions. And this demigod asks, what is the greatest surprising thing in the planet Earth? Yudhishthira replies, Dharmaraja replies, Ahan yahani bhutani yachandiha yamamandiram, gachandiha yamamandiram, seshastiram ischanti kimascharyam itapparam. It's a beautiful Sanskrit verse. He says, every moment, every day, we see so many people going to Yama's abode, means dying. Even then, every soul, every person who lives here
thinks that he is not going to die. Only others are going to die. He is going to be here forever. Something which gives you that confident. There is some energy, something which is constantly giving you the idea that you are going to be here forever. That is what we call Atman. Every one of you, every one of us experience that self, but unfortunately not all the time. Every one of us have got some experience or at least a vague idea of that self. Otherwise, holding on to this body, there can be no logic that you having strong belief or faith that you will never die, you will never perish. Even holding this body, you have some idea, some one corner, how many times you try to remind, at some part of your being, corner of your being, that idea is there that you won't perish. You won't perish. You won't die. Atmaspurana. Word means flowering of the self. That self, the consciousness which is in you, making it alive, making it as a solid experience for you throughout your life. That is the purpose of the whole program. The goal or purpose of the whole program is, in every one of you, there is a experience of self, making that alive, making that as a direct experience, living experience for the whole life. This whole program is based on Taittiriya Upanishad. The basic techniques are the ideas which we are going to work, which we are going to practice are from Taittiriya Upanishad. The word Upanishad is a very powerful word. The translation of that word is just sitting, nothing else. Just sitting can do so much in you. Sitting in the presence of the Master, sitting with the Master can do so much in you. That is why all the Vedic scriptures, the essence of the Vedic scriptures are called Upanishad. If you have done our first level programs like Ananda Spurana, LBP, Nityananda Spurana, all these programs, they are all technique based. Technique based means you will be taught some techniques here, you can practice here, you can go back to the home and practice there. Technique based. The effort you put, that much you will grow. That will become experience. It happens. There is a next level program. If you have done Dhyana Spurana or Nityanandam, they are all no technique based. There won't be any technique. Just the understanding. Understanding itself can add so much to you. Just a simple understanding. Changing your idea about yourself and the world and the cosmic energy. Jiva, Ishvara, Jagat. If your ideas about these three changes, you will just transformed. You will be transformed. This is a second level. Now, this program is neither technique based nor no technique based. It is neither technique based nor no technique based. Technique based means you will learn something to be done here and you can go back to the home and practice. You will not receive anything like that now. You will not receive anything which you can practice in the home. No. No technique based means just understanding, nothing else. You will not be doing anything. But now, it's not that you are going to keep quiet. It's neither technique based nor no technique based. It is called process. Alchemy. When you sit with the master, the Upanishad, when the sitting happens, some strange process starts happening in you, which can neither be called as technique nor no technique. It's literally like a cooking, boiling. By tomorrow evening, you are expected to be completely boiled. In Sanskrit, we have a word siddha. Siddha means two meaning. One, enlightened. Another one, cooked. Boiled. So by tomorrow evening, you are expected to be completely boiled or cooked. Siddha. It's just like adding something to you and taking something away from you. Whatever can be taken away will be taken away. Whatever needs to be added will be added. And the master's presence is like a fire. Just like cooking. You add something, you remove something, and the fire, the presence of the fire, when all these things are done, cooking happens. This is more a process. Why I want to give this detailed introduction to you? Please do not miss even a single session. With the technique based course programs, if you miss one or two technique, no problem. You will have 80% result. With a no technique based program, you don't even need to come for that program. Just DVD is enough. Just video is enough. Your physical presence is not needed. But now, not only your physical presence, my physical presence also is needed. Both of us need to sit with each other. That is why this Upanishad starts with a beautiful mantra. Let us enter into that mantra next. For next 2 days, please decide very clearly you are going to be here. The whole program, people will come and ask, Swamiji, I have to go and pick up my kids. Can I go and come back? And in this country, God, in India, we do this Atmasmarana 4 days. But you know, in this country, even if God comes, he has to come in the weekend. If he comes in the weekdays, please give your mail ID, we'll get back to you. But at least this weekend, let us be completely with this Upanishad. Please do not miss even a single session. Just be with the whole flow. You can be relaxed, no need to be very serious or... Of course, if you are checking out, then you will be serious. Too serious, trying to constantly judge me, what I am doing, what I am doing, what I am doing. Don't bother, relax. I am already judged by 1.2 million people around the world. If you are sitting here, waiting and judging, 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 you are going to miss. Just relax. That's a big problem. If you are judging, you will be wasting your time. Maybe tomorrow by evening start judging. Till then relax. Nothing wrong. Judging is nothing wrong. Those preliminary programs like LBP, NSP, Dhyanasmarana, all those programs I have created for the people who are first timers who are judging. This program I have designed more for the people who are really interested in diving deep. The other programs aiming at breadth, this program is aiming at depth. So, unfortunately, if you have not done any of the checking out programs earlier itself, decide not to waste your time. Decide. If you already checked out a little bit, then you won't have a problem. You will be completely ready to dive in, jump. Just for 2 days, don't bother about much judging, just dive deep into your being. One more thing, you will not even be able to understand anything about me unless you dive into the technology I have created. Otherwise, you can't judge. Unless you yourself have one experience, you can't understand whether I had it or not. Only when you have some experience, you can understand. So even if you want to judge me, jump completely inside. Only then you will be able to judge properly. If you are standing outside and judging, then you are a critic, not a seeker. Two way of looking at things, understand? A positive doubt, maybe what he is saying is right. No, nothing is right. Two way of looking at things. If you just have that maybe, that's enough. The scientist's mind, a beginner's mind, how a scientist approaches a theory, same way, approach the beginner's mind, then so much can happen, so much of work can be done. Otherwise, you will be just sitting and wasting your time and my time. Upanishad is a very powerful process. I request you not to miss even a single session. Next thing, for Upanishads to happen, you need to be here and now. You need to be completely here and now. Means two things. One, you can't sleep. Next, you need to be inside your boundary. Your bodies are not your homes. It is more like your hotels, your lodges. You put your luggage in that and start roaming around. That is the way you use your body, understand? Your bodies are not your homes. You put your luggage and start going around, sightseeing. But for these 2 days, you are expected to be inside your home. You are expected to be inside your home and no sleeping. There's a small story. I always love to tell this story because I myself enjoy this story. One great preacher, a man who is preaching the name of the God all over the world, and the wild taxi driver, maybe from Chennai or New York or Calcutta. Calcutta is number one. Maybe Chennai gets number two, then New York. The other day I read the CNN, they say that driving license, some exam, some written exam was there. New York drivers are the lowest score. I was surprised. India means they wouldn't have appeared even for exam. In Calcutta or Chennai, you can't even expect them to come for the exam. In Chennai, they may come to receive just the license. In Calcutta, you have to go and deliver the license and come back. Even to give the license, you may have to go to their home. Anyhow, one taxi driver and this great preacher, both of them died. Reached the Yama's court, Lord of Death. Yama is doing his regular inquiry. First, the taxi driver came, as usual, fast. Yama asked, what were you doing? I was driving taxi. Then he just saw the list of the sin and merit. Now they are computerized. Tuck, tuck, tuck. Saw the whole list and said, all right. Have the golden key, go to heaven. Then next the preacher came. Yama asked, what were you doing? What's your name? I was spreading Lord's name all over the planet Earth. He started giving his regular sermon, as usual. Memorized, usually it will be memorized. And Yama said, stop, 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 relax. Then he saw the list of sin and merits. He said, I think you need to go to hell. The moment the preacher heard this, he started shouting, what? Just for a taxi driver you gave heaven? How dare you send me to hell? I'll sue you, maybe from West, from US. Shouting. Preachers are professional shouters. That is another thing. Shouting. Yama said, relax. Here up in the heaven, we don't bother what you do. We bother the result. This taxi driver guy, even though he was driving taxi, he was so wild in his driving, people were sitting inside the taxi and outside. All of them were praying for their life. He made so many people thieves. He made them all believers of God. What he does is secondary. But the effect of his action, he converted many of them into believers. But you, even though you were preaching in such a way people were sleeping. Understand, the problem is, if you sleep now, when I go there, I will have a problem. May not be for your sake, at least for my sake, don't sleep. When I go there, I'll be given the hell's key. So at least for my sake, no sleeping. We are going to directly deal with how you are living. So now, we can't afford to sleep. Neither you can afford to sleep, nor I can afford to sleep. So both of us have to remain awake. Do something. What you will do is up to you. But we can't afford to sleep. Because there are so many things involved with the sleeping. When I go there, I'll have a problem. At least for that sake, I can't let you guys sleep. Second thing. First thing, no sleeping. Second thing, sitting inside your boundary. This is a very important thing to be understood. Just see your life, early morning, when you get, early morning you don't get up, that is different. When you get out of your bed and start brushing, if at all, already your mind is sitting in the office, thinking about your boss, thinking about the answers you are supposed to give, thinking about the work. By the time you reach your office and sitting in the office, already your mind is in the beach, evening. Thinking about the beach or the weekend vacation. If you are in the beach, evening, already your mind is thinking when to go back to the home. It is cold, it is something this, that. The funny part of your mind is, when you see a beautiful scenery in the TV or advertisement, like beautiful beach or beautiful forest or a snow-covered mountain, you always feel you should be there. And if you are there, you will be in ecstasy. That is the idea you get, especially the resort advertisements. And you almost feel, if you are lying in that chair, near that swimming pool, in that beach, you will be in heaven. But when you go there itself, you don't see that experience. Why? What is happening? Why, when we see visually, it gives, it feels that we will be in ecstasy. When we go there, it is not an experience. It's not becoming an experience. First thing, the moment you are in the beach, already your mind has started thinking about when to be in the home. When you are back in the home, already your mind has started thinking about next day routine. If your body is here, one thing is sure, you are not here. Now for this next 2 days, you will not use your body as a lodge or a hotel. You will use your body as a home. Come back. Just be inside your boundary. Only then I can work with you. You and me, both of us need to sit with each other. Understand? You and me, both of us need to sit with each other. It means what? Both of us need to sit with each other. You can't be somewhere, then I can't work on you. You need to be here, only then I can work with you. You need to be inside your boundary. Your skin is supposed to be your boundary, at least till you become enlightened. After you become enlightened, how alive you feel inside your skin, the same life you will feel inside every skin. Inside this pillow, inside this seat, inside everything, you will feel that same life. At least now, skin is your boundary. That is your boundary. Come back. Come back. Be inside your skin, inside your boundary. Only then, the Upanishad can happen. Both of us need to sit with each other. That is why this Upanishad starts with a beautiful mantra. Sahana vavatu, sahanau bunaktu, sahaviryam karavavahai, tejasvi navadita mastu mavit vishavahai. Beautiful mantra. Let both of us not hate each other. Let both of us grow together. The beauty of the education in Vedic tradition is not egocentric. The master says, let both of us grow. He is not saying, let you grow, I will teach you. No. He is saying, let both of us grow. That's the truth. That is the truth. Let both of us work with each other. Let both of us not hate each other till we end the process. Let both of us feel connected at least till tomorrow evening. Understand? You may sit here like as you are attending a weekend workshop or a management course. Any attitude is okay, no problem. But decide, these 2 days you will sit sincerely with the whole process. I am not asking you to accept me as your guru and all. I am not asking. Actually, people ask me, Swami, should I accept you as a guru? I say, no. If I am your guru, this question will not raise. As long as this question is there, I am not your guru. Forget about it. Search, seek. And the people, one more thing. I always tell people, even if you accept me as a guru, there is nothing wrong learning from some other source or some other master or some other place. I always tell people, pluck flowers from all gardens and make a beautiful bouquet for yourself. Nothing is wrong. After all, I am here to enrich your life. If somebody else also is enriching, observe. What's wrong? It's not like a shop. If you come to my shop, don't go to other shop. This is not mom shop, pop shop. Or mom and pop shop. It's not a shop. If you come here, don't go there. Nothing. Enrich yourself. Wherever you can. Or whatever way you can. Just these 2 days, don't bother about this or that or with all your internal struggles and unnecessary useless questions. Just sit with a deep, receiving, receptive, prayerful mood inside your boundary. The whole process can happen. The whole process can happen. The Upanishad can start happening. Till tomorrow evening, let us not hate each other. Because I am going to make you do all sorts of things. Means your food will be little delayed. Your sleep will be little delayed. Your daily routine may be little delayed. You may face little so-called uncomforts. Do not grumble or grudge. Even if you grumble, I am not going to leave you. See, program is fixed. Either you go through with the complete acceptance or with the struggle is up to you. I have no problem. But you are going to go through. There is one option I give. If you go through without struggling, it will be a lot more easy for you. That's all. So let us not hate each other. Let us feel connected to each other. Let us grow together. That is the beauty of Vedic masters. Enlightenment is ultimate experience, but not final. See, understand, the ultimate happening every moment is enlightenment. So every moment, an enlightened being is exploding and growing, expanding. You may think, how can an enlightened person grow? Maybe the growing word is not a proper word. The ultimate experience happening every moment, it's ultimate. Enlightenment is ultimate. But it's not that it happens once and stops. It is happening continuously. It is right word is enlightening, not even enlightenment. It is not noun, it is a verb. That's the truth. It is a verb. Enlightening. Continuously, that experience is happening. That is why Master says, let us grow together. Let us grow together. Sahana vavatu. Sahanao bunaktu. Sahaviryam karavavahi. Let both of us grow together. For that, we need a simple, honest friendliness. Feeling connected, respect for each other, and conscious decision to work together till tomorrow evening is enough. I am not asking whole life. No, that is too much. That is too much. Till tomorrow evening. Till tomorrow evening, let us work together and be inside your skin. That's enough. Everything else will simply start happening. The Master's presence is very powerful, even if you don't understand. Whether you understand or not, when you sit next to fire, you will have that effect. You will feel that heat. Whether you understand or not, when you sit next to the Master, you will see that starts happening inside. Enlightened consciousness is much more powerful than your doubting logic. It can penetrate you. People ask me, should I trust you? Should I believe you? I say, no, no need. Your doubt and trust both are shallow. Neither your doubt is strong nor your trust is strong. Both are just shallow. Enlightened consciousness is much more powerful than your doubt or trust. Both are depending on your mind. But enlightened consciousness is beyond mind. It can straight away work on you. Do not bother whether you have doubt or whether you have trust or whether you have faith or anything. Sit with a deep receptive mood. And the beginner's mind, mood to go through the process. Mind, willingness to go through the process and inside your skin. That's enough. We will see that the process happens. The Upanishad starts happening. I'll just give a simple understanding about how the mind works. and how exactly the Upanishad is going to help us. Let me once more explain the word Upanishad. Just sitting. Maybe if I have to give the commentary for that word, sitting with the enlightened being. That's all is the Upanishad. Let's first understand how our mind works. With a simple drawing. Bhaktananda, do you have a sketch? Oh, all right. Can you? This cloth is created for renunciation. You can't hold anything. That's the problem. No packet or anything. You can't tie or hold anything in this cloth. I'm just giving you a simple explanation on how the mind works. Your mind is nothing but making your future into past. Understand? What you call as life is nothing but swallowing your future and making it into past. Am I right? It is just every moment constantly you swallow the future and make it into past. The future becoming past is what you call your mind or whatever you know as life. Nothing else. Just a time shaft. The past. Becoming. Or the future becoming past. Future is entering into past. The space where this future and past meets, that is what we call present moment. Future is constantly entering into past, becoming past is what we call your mind. Where the past and the future meets is the present moment, this moment. Past, for explanation's sake, I am just redrawing once more time. The future is just disappearing into the past, like this is the way it is going, it's moving. Understand every step you need to understand completely, only then you will be able to go with it. A little bit of introduction about the mind is good. This is like a user's manual, owner's manual for mind. Not even user's, owner's manual. Usually nobody, many people don't use, that is different. But if you own, better to have. See, even though you have a car, the moment you sit and put the seat belt, there is a big the information about airbag, and it says for further details see the owner's manual. How many of us have referred the owner's manual about the airbag? At least with airbag it is okay, even if you don't refer, because it is going to be useful only when you have the accidents. But if you don't have the owner's manual for mind, you will create accidents. And you will not even know that you are going through accidents every day. So better to have owner's manual for mind. This is the present moment where the future is disappearing into past. This moment, maybe we can call as a present. Spelling is okay. Spelling is right. Ah, okay. Because the see in the law firms, there's the best kept secret is that senior lawyers have forgotten how to argue, because they have just started managing. Only juniors go and regularly argue. Just like that, I forgot how to write because I'm not writing. I'm only speaking. Sometime I have to refer the spelling. Anyway, in the laptop, no problem, the spell check is there. Now that creates all problem. When I type Devi and type for spell check, it gives the option of devil. Because it can't read the Sanskrit words. That's another one problem. Anyhow. Your mind, understand now these few statements, if you completely grasp, you will realize the truth. Your mind is nothing but jumping from past to future and past to future. Am I right? Thought is nothing but jumping from past to future or future to past. You can't think in the present moment. Try to create a single thought in present moment, you can't. The moment you come back to present moment, thoughts will disappear. Thinking is happening means you are jumping from past to future or future to past. Means here to here, here to here, here to here. This is what we call thought. Am I right? For example, if you are jumping 100 times from past to future, future to past, you have 100 thought per second. Per second, how many times you are jumping from past to future, future to past, that many number of thoughts you have. Are you able to grasp? If any of you have any doubt, put it in writing. End of the session, I will answer. Because this needs to be completely internalized by you. Understand? Only if the internalization happens, you will involve in the whole process. You see, you will do all sorts of illogical things, nonsensical things for any pleasure. But even to move one hand for spirituality, you will have 1,000 questions. And you think you are very intelligent. Now that is the problem. See, for other things, you will do all sorts of things without even bothering, and even if your logic says it is not good. Many people come and tell me that smoking is bad, I know, but I am not able to drop, what to do? I have to give honey. Usually I energize and give the honey for de-addiction. Anyhow, even if you know it is not good, your logic says you will do when it comes to pleasure. But when it comes to any meditation or spiritual things, even a small thing, you will have too many logical questions. And you think because of that, because you are asking all logical questions for spirituality, you are very intelligent. Or you have the pride. I don't believe in superstitious things. And you don't understand how many thousands of nonsensical superstitious things you have. First idea, your body is the first superstition you are carrying. Instead of looking into those big superstitious things you are carrying, the small things you think as a superstitious things. Anyhow, now at least internalize this so that you will be ready for the process. You will be ready for the process. If you are jumping from past to future, future to past, 100 times per second, you are having 100 thought per second. Let's call it as a TPS, part per second. 100 TPS, for example. Maybe, when you are having 100 TPS, you will be away from the present moment. Am I right? This is the present moment where the future and past meets. If you are jumping too many times, that's what is going on now. Naturally, you will be away from the past, away from the present. You will never be in the present moment. Because in the present moment, you can't think. There won't be any thought. In the present moment, if you come back to present moment, there will be only beautiful silence. The more number of time you are jumping between past and the present and past and the future, more number of thoughts. For example, 100 TPS means you are completely away from the present moment. What is happening in the present? Nobody bothers. Even if I am standing and talking here, you just pick up one thought and compare with what all you heard in your past lectures, discourses, classes, what you read. You will be now sitting and having a big comparison notes and you miss all other statements. Now that is the problem. See, I am not saying whatever you heard is wrong or something, but now sitting and analyzing is wrong. Because you are going to miss my next statement. If you are sitting here, and the problem with the so-called spiritual seekers is well-read, and completely confused. Thoroughly confused, well-read, and you can't do anything to help them, because any statement I make, now this fellow will be sitting and having 10 dictionary. And 10 references. In that book it says like that, in that book it says like that. This guy will be doing two things. Either referring all these things, and if all those books also says the same thing, or if he finds some relationship, he will say, oh, what he is saying is right. Or if he does not find right quotation or matching, this is not right. I think he doesn't know completely. He is too young. After all, he is young. Leave it. That's the problem. See, whether you say yes or no, by comparing notes, you are not going to grasp. Even if you say yes, you are going to miss the other statements which I am making. By the time you finish your analysis and come back, I have already gone 10 steps ahead. Now, just keep all the things which you read, studied, heard, one corner. For 2 days, when you go back, you pick it up. I'm not saying completely to throw away. Just for 2 days. Go into it completely and understand, internalize. If you are jumping between this and that, you will be away from the past, away from the present. Maybe, fortunately, sometime, you do some meditation or some pranayama or some kind of a technique. Then maybe if you bring your TPS down, means the jumping between future and past to 80 TPS, 80 thoughts per second, 80, instead of jumping 100 times, you jump 80 times. You come down little bit towards the present moment. Am I right? If you do something else and jump and reduce the jumping to 60, you come down little more to the present moment. And if you reduce it to 40, sometime, very rarely, the powerful techniques are the blessings of an enlightened guru can bring it down to 20, even 20 TPS. See, this is just an example I am giving. It's not that you are now in 100 TPS, you are maybe in 1000 or 2000. I don't think you will be in 100. Maybe it may be even million, I don't know. One person is zero TPS. Aha. Sometimes even silence, people wake up. Wake up call happens. Oh, she is beyond that source also. Okay. See, my talking sometimes feels like a lullaby. So you feel nicely. Nicely relaxed and taken care. When I give the break, suddenly you understand something is wrong. And you wake up. And the fun part is when these guys wake up, first thing they will do is looking at others. If you are looking at others, understand you are the person who slept. Not the neighbor. Now that is the fun part. And sometimes these guys they will be just sitting and sleep. First they will start with let me listen with closed eyes. They will have a justification, I am meditating and listening. And the next person pokes. I am listening. They won't even open the mouth to tell I am listening, because the sleep will be disturbed if you talk. They'll say, you attend, you listen, I am okay. I am listening. These guys, what to do? Huh? I always tell people that meditative listeners are the people who are thinking something else, are lost somewhere. Rarely by the presence of the master you come down to some initiation or some process can bring it down even to 20 TPS. When you come to the present moment, step by step, step by step, step by step, when you come, suddenly you will have the intelligence of seeing the future and the past clearly. Understand? From this place, can you see the past or the future clearly? No. You can't even see the past or the future clearly. When you come down, you may be able to see a little better. See, from here, you can see only like this much, maybe that also. From here, little more your vision will improve. From here, 60 TPS you may improve, little more. From 40, little more, you may be able to see. When your TPS reduces, you will have the intelligence to see the past and future. One important thing, now it feels like I am giving you a big promise. If you come to the present moment, you can see your future. So naturally it looks like a big promise or too good to be true. Let us analyze one important thing. Sometime when you are in a party, suddenly you will think that some person is going to come in next few minutes and you will see that person is there. And sometime when telephone rings, suddenly you remember somebody whom you did not remember for 2 years, and when you pick up the phone, that person is online. When a doorbell rings, suddenly you remember a relative who has not come to your home for 5 years, or whom you have not remembered for forgotten for 5 years. When you open the door, that guy is standing there. How many of you had this kind of experience at least once or twice in your life? Wow. Understand? If it happens, but when it happens, what do you do usually in the mind? A coincidence. Am I right? If it happens in one person's life once, it can be called as coincidence. Am I right? Practically now 98% of you say that you had this experience. When 98% of you had the experience, how can this be called as coincidence? You can't brush this aside in the name of coincidence. Am I right? If 98% of the people are experiencing, how can that be called by the word coincidence? No. Then you need to change the meaning of the word coincidence. Coincidence means what? Rarely, in some one or two person's life, which happens, may not. But now, the evidence says 98% of the people, in 98% life, 98% of the people, in 98% of the people are experiencing means, how can that be called as coincidence? There is something more than coincidence in this thing. We can't brush this aside just in the name of coincidence. This is what we call intuition. Means, when that doorbell was ringing, or when that cell phone was ringing, maybe sudden jerk or some reason, your TPS dropped. When the TPS drops, it can drop even by force sometime. When TPS dropped, you are able to see the future, next 5 minutes of the future, clearly. You had the glimpse of time shaft. This is the time shaft. The future disappearing into the past. When the TPS dropped, it can drop at any moment by sudden. When something suddenly happens, when your mind is not capable enough of processing that information, suddenly the TPS drops. When the TPS drops, you saw the future. Just you had the glimpse of the future. Next 5 minutes, what is going to happen? I think you are able to connect with what I am saying. That is the reason you are able to see or think who is going to come or what is going to happen. See, suddenly a doorbell ringing, or the cell phone ringing, or even if you are really relaxed and happy, sometime in some parties when you don't have your direct relatives, your in-laws, you may be completely relaxed. Maybe suddenly the TPS has come down. That is the reason. You had the glimpse of next 5 minutes of your future. If you are, see, if your TPS falls accidentally itself, you have the glimpse of your future. If it can be brought down consciously, then understand the value, understand the experiences, understand the clarity which can be added into yourself. If it drops even accidentally, you will have the glimpse of the future. All of you are able to see because I am hiding. Now seeing this face won't help. This has to, later on that will help. First now, only understanding this will help. This side okay? This whole program is all about, you are not able to. Then, I think, okay, then I have to repeat the whole thing once more. Okay, you understood? All right, otherwise you will be doing something else. Better to understand all these things, because even if you miss a single statement, you may miss and miss the whole thing. It's a very step-by-step understanding which you need to go through, but it's worthy of understanding. Now the next few statements which I am going to make are very mystical. Understand? Now whatever I spoke looks very logical, and they are logical. The next few statements are going to be very mystical. Enlightened person is a person who is established in the present moment, whose energy is in zero TPS. He is neither lost in the future nor lost in the past. Understand? The first statement which I am making, enlightened person is a person who is established in the present. If you can bring down your TPS and establish yourself in the present, you are enlightened. One more thing, future, past, present, all these three put together only is called as eternal. Am I right? Eternal means nitya. Eternal. You can touch the eternity only in the present moment. See, the eternity itself can be touched only by present moment. You can't touch the eternity through future or past, because both of them does not exist directly under your control. Past, you can't catch the past. It's not there. You can't catch the future. It's not there. You can touch only the present moment. If you want to enter into that eternal bliss or the present moment, enlightenment, the only way is to bring down your TPS to the present moment. To the present moment. One thing, enlightened person is a person who is established in the present moment. The next few statements which you need to understand. If you are in 100 TPS, you are in the presence of a being who is in 0 TPS, means the present moment, something happens in you, your time shaft also starts slowing down. This is what I was saying, very mystical. Understand? Very mystical. The person who is in 100 TPS, if he comes and sits with a being who is in 0 TPS, suddenly the TPS drops drastically. Fortunately, enlightened person's TPS can't be raised by you. Only you can be dropped by him. Fortunately, he can't be raised by you. Now you need to understand a little deeply how it drops. As you think, we are all not disconnected, separate islands. Even though civilization constantly teaches you, we are not disconnected individual islands. Maybe in the physical layer, you are all individual islands. If the food is poisoned, only the person who eats will suffer. But if the air is poisoned, the poisoned gas is inside, whoever is breathing will suffer. Means in pranic layer, second layer, the distance between all of us is reduced. Am I right? If the mind is polluted, a bigger group will suffer. The whole state will suffer. If one polluted brain sits as a leader, you know. Now, I'm not saying anything. I am not saying anything. I am telling you, I am not saying anything. Why are you thinking something and laughing? And if one corrupted brain, one person who is disturbed in Manomaya Kosha, he can corrupt the whole state. On the next level, one corrupted visualization, atomic theory, corrupted visualization, it can destroy the whole planet Earth. Understand? Now let us analyze the this koshas. Annamaya kosha means the physical body you have. These both are closely related, that's why I am explaining. Physical body you have is the first layer. Second is all the pranic movements. Prana means air flow, air circulation happening in you is the second layer. Air circulation is not just inhaling and exhaling. There is some more process. When I come to that layer, we will discuss about it. Your inner chattering is your third layer, mental layer. Your visualization is your fourth layer, vijnanamaya kosha. Your silence or peace or bliss, which you rarely experience, is anandamaya, bliss layer. I can give the English words for that, so that you don't have to struggle with that anna, maya, and prana, maya, and all those. This becomes a maya, it's instead of maya. Physical layer, first. Second, air. This is a rough translation. Prana is not actually air, air energy. Please put up with my spelling and writing. Whatever I say, I mean, not what I write. yes, I think I am okay. I am still, only this capital letter, small letter problem, that you can manage. After this enlightenment, that verbalization has completely disappeared. That's why so much of struggle this. Air energy. Then third is mental layer, inner chattering. Inner chattering is your mental layer. Oh, it's supposed to be small e. Okay. I managed it. One nice thing with enlightenment is you can manage any situation. Some of that spontaneous intelligence will come. You can manage any situation. And the fourth is visualization. Fifth is bliss layer. Bliss or the joy, which you rarely experience. You experience only blisters, not bliss. Bliss is very rare thing. These five layers, maybe in the physical layer, we are all individual, independent islands. If your food is poisoned, only the person who eats will suffer. In air energy, the distance is little less. If the air is polluted, maybe a group of people will suffer. Mental energy, if the inner chattering is polluted, maybe the whole country under whom that person... And see, the country which is under that person or under his influence will suffer. Wrong visualization means wrong inventing. See, the inventing, discovering and all these things happens only in the visualization plan, not in mental plane, only in this plane. Einstein says, I am successful because I did whatever I did through my visualization. I am successful because I can imagine. He is not discovered atomic theory or E equal to mc square through his logic. He says, after the truth only I developed the steps. Means it was through imagination, visualization. Corrupted visualization can disturb the whole planet Earth. We are all now threatened just by that one theory. One philosophy. Today the planet Earth has got 700, planet Earth has got atomic weapons. All countries, atomic weapons put together, you can burn planet Earth for 700 times. Once burning is enough, but you have enough weapon to burn the planet Earth for 700 times. One wrong visualization, whole planet Earth can suffer. Fortunately, the bliss layer cannot be corrupted because still it is under the control of enlightened beings. Otherwise, long before we would have, the planet Earth would have disappeared, the cosmos would have perished. Fortunately, still this layer key is kept with us. It's not available for public. That is why still Earth exists. And one more thing, this is a very mystical prophecy. Don't bother, nothing, you will never perish. The global warming and all these things may come and go. It may all affect only the group of people who have created collective negativity. But never the humanity will perish. Nothing will happen to planet Earth because this layer is still under, completely properly kept under the control of enlightened beings. They manage the whole situation. At some extreme points, they interfere in these three layers, in these three, four layers. So, anyhow, all you need to understand is, you are not islands as you think. When you come under a corrupted mental layer, whether you want or not, you are suffering. Am I right?
Yes.
Same way, when you come under a pure mental layer person, a great leader, whether you want or not, you will have all the plus and joy and the positive things created. Am I right?
Yes.
Same way, whether you want or not, when you come under the presence of a person who is in the bliss layer, your TPS will come down. Are you clear about the whole thing? Whether you want or not, when you come under the presence of a bliss layer person, TPS drastically drops. That is why we say Upanishad, sitting with an enlightened being who is in the bliss layer, brings your TPS down. Question. Because the person has gone beyond the mind. He has entered into non-return zone. Fortunately. You understand? As long as you have mind, you will be disturbed. With the bliss energy, enlightened being, there is no mind to get disturbed. There is no mind to get disturbed. Rivers can dry up. Ocean cannot dry. He has become ocean. The river has entered into the ocean. That is why, instead of somebody else affecting him, he affects everybody. Person who can't be affected by others, but who affects everybody is enlightened being. Whoever comes in his presence, they are all affected, but he never gets affected. Apuyamana machala pratishtam. How the Gita says, established in the self. Anyhow, you are clear about that? The TPS coming down happens when you sit with the master. Then you may ask, then let us sit for half an hour and go away, wait 2 days unnecessarily. The problem is because you forgot how to sit. I have to teach 2 days just to make you sit. That is the problem. If I ask you to sit, you will be either sleeping or restless. Or you may start doing some japa or some mantra or something. No mantra, no technique, nothing. Just sitting. You forgot the art of just sitting. In Zen they call it Zazen. Just sitting. You forgot that. Just sitting is no more part of your being. To teach that just sitting, it takes 2 days for me. Because you know everything except sitting, except just being. That is why I have to work 2 days to bring the TPS as down as possible. You can call when you are in this under TPS, you are in Annamaya Kosha, physical layer. When you are in 80, you are in pranic layer, air energy. When you are in 60, you are in mental layer. Means when the TPS comes down, step by step, you go to the inner, deeper and deeper layers. When the TPS comes to zero, you are in bliss layer. You are in Anandamaya Kosha. Now, we will sit with Master in every layer. We will open up every layer and try to sit with Him. So that too many ways we are trying to reduce the TPS, to bring the frequency down, to reduce the thoughts per second. The whole process which we are going to do for next 2 days is sitting with a zero TPS being so that it can drop drastically. And there is one more step. You can also balance yourself to come down, to reduce the TPS and to sit with Him, because you forgot how to just sit. You learnt everything except sitting. Now we are going to do something just to stop you doing anything else. We will be doing something. Why? Otherwise you will be doing something else. Just to stop you do something, just to stop you do other things, we will be doing something. We will be doing something. So that doing only I call it as process. That doing only I call it as process. I think all of you are clear about the basic things. Maybe we will have small break. 1, 2, 3 break. And you can write your questions related to this subject. Understand, ask only about this. I don't want your questions about whether it is, there are so many, especially these guys, the moment I tell them to ask questions, first question, Vastu is true or astrology is true, or will this stone work for me or that stone work for me? If just a stone can change your life, you are nothing more than a stone. Anyhow. And no other questions, please put only on this science or whatever I spoke now. Maybe all other questions I'll answer evening or tomorrow. All your FAQs. There's a set of FAQs. If Indians are there, I know the set of questions. If Westerners are there, I know the set of questions. And if NRIs are there, there's a different kind of questions. So, all those questions I'll answer maybe by today evening or tomorrow morning. Now, we will analyze only this subject, so that we can enter into the process. We can enter into the process. 100 TPS is physical layer. 80 is air energy layer. The 60 is, this is just an understanding. Don't think exactly, no, I am in between 61 and 60. Which layer I am in, I am caught. Don't ask all those doubts. This all will be from the professional seekers. Now in the West, there is a group of people, their profession is seeking. Nothing else. Their whole day profession is just going here, going there, doing this, doing that. They will find some stone, some pendulum, something, these, that. Some crystal, they will say, oh, this is radiating energy. I could feel the energy, I could feel the energy. Somehow I didn't feel anything. No, sometimes these guys, then I just, not to hurt them, oh yes, there is a full of energy, take it and go quickly. Please go quickly. What to do? The energy is the experience which happens inside, not some stone or pendulum or some these that things. So much of nonsensical theories and books are being sold in this country. I understood one thing, anything you write which should be impractical sells here. You need just, I can give you 3 tips to become a great philosopher. Write which you yourself can't practice. Second thing, just talk only about problem, nothing else. And third thing, important thing, never give solution. You can become a great philosopher in 30 days. I don't know why so much. The problem is that you don't need enlightenment to teach in the Western developed civilizations. That is the problem. In India, somehow it is engraved in your heart. Unless you walk the path, don't talk. It is engraved in the inner space. Unless you yourself know it completely, side effect and after effect and everything, do not talk. That has gone into the system. Unless the person is enlightened, it's considered as a worst conspiracy against the humanity. Teaching before enlightenment is the worst conspiracy against enlightenment, against the humanity. If you are still seeker, and one funny thing, one beautiful thing with the Indian tradition is, if you are a seeker, you are taken care. You are not forced to do a business for your survival. You are given food, shelter, everything with respect. If we do that, then the seekers will not be forced to start teaching. They will mind only their job. All right, maybe later on we can try all these things. Put questions only on this subject, we will answer, we will study. Can I remember what you talked to me? You are great. I'm not able to read one word. Assuring words. I feel connected and in bliss. Does it mean that I am thinking of the past and living in the present? No, you are living in the present. Bliss can never be felt based on past. How can I prepare myself psychologically for enlightenment? See, your psychological preparation has no significant place in enlightenment. Enlightenment is straight away blasting you. Whether you are going to have one candle in the house or not going to have that candle is no way going to bother blasting the whole thing. So your psychological preparation is nothing more than one candle. That may help till I blast you. That's all. After blasting, whether you have it or not, is neither going to help and nor going to disturb. So your psychological preparation is not a too big thing. See, your psychological preparation will always be done with your mind. So that is not going to do big difference. Don't bother about it. Does enlightenment seem far away simply due to my own fear? That's what? Your own fear is the only problem. Don't bother about that. Just relax and sit here. After the Atmasmarana ends, I am visiting relatives that Monday evening. They ask a lot of questions. I will not feel like talking. What to do? How to keep the mind quiet even with the social pressure? I think the question must be from Indian. who put the question? All right. Oh God. Westerners also have so much of social pressure. Just don't talk to them. That's all. What is there? What relative is that? I thought only in India so much of this relation, social pressure and all these things exist. Somebody says, when I do the meditation, I start feeling different and I get anxious and afraid. Who? Unless I know the who, I won't be able to answer. Okay, it will become all right. Don't worry. It's just the initial level. Just it can be taken away. And you put my cartoon also, like a ghost. Thank you for your cartoon. Somebody is asking, are you the Kali avatar? Whether I am avatar or not, don't bother. Just You realize that you are avatar, that's all. Oh, no question related to this subject.
Huh? There are some questions there from the box which I put to the side.
Mm. No. There is one question. Sometimes what we see in dreams comes out to be true in the following day. Is it because of zero TPS? Who is the questioner? Satya? One thing, not because of zero TPS, in the dream, you pass through the anandamaya, vijnanamaya kosha to anandamaya kosha, means the fourth layer to fifth layer. The space between fourth and fifth layer is the place where you fall asleep, deep sleep. When you pass through, you pick up one or two rare truth from the vijnanamaya. Vijnanamaya kosha is the area where you dream. You just pick up one or two things. That does not mean that you are entering into zero TPS. Just like that's a side effect, byproduct. But what happens during waking state is a zero TPS experience. If you see your future in the waking state, it's a zero TPS experience. But in the dream state, it's just an accident. You said that the TPS can be reduced when sitting in the presence of an enlightened master. Now you said that the TPS can be reduced when sitting in the presence of an enlightened master. You are here, and when we are able to reduce our TPS in your presence, apart from this method, is there any way in which we can reduce TPS in day-to-day life? Nitya Dhyan will create the master's presence. So that is the meditation I prescribe to bring your TPS down. Maybe by tomorrow evening you can learn that. Now let us go through the process. I just want to push you at least once to zero TPS. At least one moment, one glimpse. Then we will talk about the technique to carry that same smell, that bliss with you. The koshas. First, I want to make sure that you all understood, internalized. That is why I am serious about these layers, panchakoshas. Is there a correspondence between chakras and koshas? No, no correspondence. If to be in the present implies in not thinking, then how could a scientist or wise man make decisions and still live in the present moment? Whatever they discovered only in the present moment, without any thought. It was like a revelation. So no great decision is made in the past or future. If something is made like that, it is not great decision. That kind of decision, what it does to the society, you will know. You said that enlightened beings will interfere when there are destructive visualization that can put in danger to our planet in this case. So is that these enlightened beings did not interfere with the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki? It was too small to be interfered by them. When it really threatens the whole planet Earth, they interfere. There have been many times during last 2 years, zero TPS, expansiveness, bliss, spaciousness, but mind identity always comes back out to fully established in zero TPS. Without returning mind identity ego. Getting established is a thing achieved by the practice, sadhana. No. Somebody is asking, artists have high TPS or low TPS? They have low TPS. Artists come down even to 40 or 20. Sometimes we have a bad dream. Does that mean our Vijnanamaya Kosha is corrupted? Yes. Is eternity what is in presence means? Yes. If you are in the present moment, you are in eternity. I understand that I can have zero TPS only in your presence or when I became enlightened person. In master enlightened person's presence, zero TPS will start. It will stay with you when you become enlightened. I can give you the glimpse of zero TPS. If you decide to stay in that same, you will become enlightened. When you become enlightened, naturally you will be staying the same in the same state. That's all. Is zero TPS, keeping zero TPS at zero? Is keeping TPS at zero a state we want to always stay in? If yes, then how do you do your day-to-day activities, jobs, etc.? In zero TPS, you will be highly productive. Very highly productive, because you are not wasting your energy in the just unnecessary thoughts. You are not jumping into past and future. Your decisions will be so sharp. You will become a leader. Zero TPS is a very powerful energy zone. So much energy will radiate. You will never become mentally tired. You will never become mentally saying, no, enough, I have done. It will never be the case. You will be so joyful and ecstatic. You will become more productive. Because productivity is disturbed. See, to tell you honestly, you guys don't spend much time in producing and all. Just selling you, by you guys selling you only, you are wasting your time. Nothing much. The corporate circle, nothing much happens except talking, project plan, projecting that laptop and cheating the boss. Now, I know the many teams just justify their existence by doing the same thing for last 2-3 years. If you guys take Atmasmarana, your energy will, your productivity and energy will become so beautiful. You will just, you will excel just out of your quality, not out of your marketing ability. And moreover, when you just excel out of quality, you feel so fulfilled. See, dharma always gives you fulfillment. The person who honestly works, instead of wasting his time, you see, the person who sells himself can become, he can get into the politics and may even raise to the high level of post, promotion and all those things. He will never have fulfillment. Very shallow, vague, idiotic being he will be. So a person who is dharmic and being productive will be so fulfilled. He will feel so deeply fulfilled. So naturally he may raise out of his own quality. So, but living without selling gives a strong fulfillment. The selling may happen as a byproduct, one or two small incident. It won't be a big thing. Put your energy more on being. You will see you become such productive. Apart from productive to the company, you will feel so fulfilled in your personal life. You will feel that you are dharmic. You are living a beautiful, fulfilled life. A real zero TPS person will be very dharmic and productive. How do you stay in the eternal present and deal with the future, past, for working in the world as you do? I don't work with the past and future. I am just playing the... one more thing, when you actually establish in the present moment, you can just stop and see the past or future as you want. Time shaft is completely like a game, video game. You can rewind, fast forward. If some old people are going to talk about good experiences or bad experiences again and not accepting the present, how will it affect the younger generation who is also pulled into it? I think you are talking about your in-laws or grandparents. Somehow, when the present is not enjoyable for them, they are caught in the old. And they will catch you and start telling you all the stories. That is another one big difficulty. In 1963, when I was in the army, and these army retired guys, most dangerous fellows. In India, I have seen only those few guys, they will start telling every story. And the problem is, they will tell the same story every day. They won't even think that grandkids have a little memory. Just because I can't speak back or I can't shout at him, because in the end of that story they will give a little candy or something. So we will have to be sitting and listening to the whole same story. Sometime I will shout, no, I told, I know the story, I can tell you the story what you told. You say, no, there is something new. No, he thinks he is confident enough to build something new, but he will not be able to even do that. Even if he has created something new, it will be a little funny. To listen, these guys don't even have that much of creativity. And telling the same story sometime, what to do? How do they handle it? No, they don't have to handle it, you have to only handle them. What to do? Nothing much can be done. Only thing you have to decide to renounce or sacrifice the candy. But that I realize now only. Not at that time. No other way you have to go through. If you have a brief glimpse into the zero TPS, why do we bounce back into the mental or physical layer soon? Why can't we go deeper and experience the bliss completely? Only I have to ask you. You are asking me? I should ask you, when you can have one glimpse, why don't you go into the bliss layer and be in zero TPS? You only want to come out, you are coming out. Maybe your samskaras, engrams, engraved memories again and again bring you out. If I meditate with another person who is also meditating regularly, both me and the other person experience deeper state of meditation, meditate effortlessly, then when we do individually, if I meditate with a restless person in a group, my TPS goes higher or compared to individual meditators. One thing, group meditation always leads to low TPS. It always leads to low TPS. Especially in our satsangs, I have given a promise, wherever my people sit and meditate, I'll be there. Wherever my people gather together to talk about me or to listen to the talk from me, I'll be there. Wherever my people dance, I'll be there in the midst, dancing. So, group meditation will always bring down your TPS. Don't bother about it. If each teacher and student both become changed through interactions, how is it that TPS does not increase by the enlightened master when energy is shared? This is a nice question. Understand, when enlightened rishis say, let both of us grow, it does not really mean that I am going to grow by you. It shows their humbleness, their openness. Don't think I am going to learn from you. So be relaxed. Be relaxed. It just shows the humbleness. See, when I do namaskar to you, I am not coming down to your level. I am just bringing you up to my level. Really, it happened once in India. When I entered the hall, there was one elderly person standing. As usual, I did namaskar. That person, instead of doing namaskar, he just blessed me. And the person who was standing next to him asked, hey, you are blessing this? Swamiji is doing namaskar. No, he is after all a young person, younger than me. I can bless him. Then I told him, when I bow down, I raise you to my level, not that I come down to your level. So, relax, I am not going to learn from you. You are going to learn from me, that is the truth. When masters say that, it shows their humbleness and openness and respect for you. That does not mean, of course, if I have to learn from you, what will happen to me? You will reproduce you on me. So don't bother about it. Who put the question? Okay, nice. All right, I think other things I answered.